Welcome to AKS Daily News Analysis of the Hindu newspaper dated 20th January 2020 of Hyderabad edition. The first article here for discussion is about the center who are trying to form a tougher law against the sexual harassment at work. The group of ministers which have finalized the recommendations are going to put forward this particular law for the public comments. This particular group of ministers was constituted in October 2018 after the Me Too movement, which witnessed many women sharing their ordeal of sexual harassment on the social media, right? So this group of ministers constituted to strengthen the legal framework to prevent the sexual harassment at the workplace. Now the group of ministers was reconstituted in July 2019, which included Minister Smriti Irani as well as the Finance Minister Nirmala Sitaram and our Home Minister. It was headed by the Home Minister Amit Shah. It is mostly this law, it is just an acknowledgement in order to need a law to change with the time, because this sexual harassment of women at workplace needs to be strengthened with the suitable amendments. The earliest acts which were in place did not actually give the concern representment to the women who were actually being harassed at the workplace, right? So now if we see the history of this present bill, this sexual harassment bill was taken up on based on the Vishakha guidelines which were laid by the Supreme Court in 1997. The Ministry for Women and Child Development has brought about this act called as the Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace and the Prevention and Prohibition and Redressal Act in 2013. This act is particularly applicable to the government offices, private sector, NGOs and even the unorganized sector. So here the act requires that the employer to provide a requisite assistance to a woman if she chooses to file a complaint under the IPC against the predator after the conclusion of the inquiry, right? So now for this purpose, the act also constituted internal complaints committee, right? This internal complaint committee had a power of a civil court, and without specifying if the members needs to have any legal background, this act just told that there should internal complaints committee, right? This has come after the Me Too movement which has started on the social media that we have seen. Many of even the Hollywood stars were named in after the Me Too movement, and this movement also continued in India, right? So this occurred not only that, but as per the National Crime Records Bureau, the number of sexual harassment incident at work or the office premises were around 479, and compared to the year in 2018, which was only 401, right? So here it shows the total number of sexual harassment incidents in 2018, including that in the public places, shelter houses and others, were around 20,962. So because this number of cases have been continually high, getting higher, so the effectiveness of the 2013 Act was not able to readdress the whatever the problems that the women were facing in India. That is the reason they have formed this group of ministers in 2018, which witnessed many women sharing their ordeal on sexual harassment on social media. So it is this, they are going to strengthen the legal framework. So for this purpose, after they have put up the recommendations, now they have put this on the portal so that it can bring about the public opinion on the redressal mechanism for the women. So here the major recommendations include addition of new provisions to the IPC, which would strengthen the existing laws on sexual harassment at the workplace. This particular amendment will form the part of Ministry of Home Affairs, because it comes, the reboot of IPC comes under the Ministry of Home Affairs. That is the reason whatever the amendment that they are intending to bring will also bring in the change in the amendments will be directed towards the Ministry of Home Affairs. The article here is talking about the Bangladesh Prime Minister reaction that she had to tell about the Citizenship Amendment Act. We have seen that Citizenship Amendment Act talks about to give a citizenship to the people, minority people who are persecuted in the name of religion from the three countries, including Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Bangladesh, who come from the six different religions. We have seen how much the world is showing a lot of ire on India, especially after the NRC and CA protests that are taking place in our country, as well as the restrictions that are imposed on the Jammu and Kashmir. But for the first time, a Prime Minister has talked about the CAA, that is Citizenship Amendment Act, and that is Sheikh Hasina has said that the India citizenship law was unnecessary. Not only that, not only it brought the reaction of the Bangladesh Prime Minister, but also the President of Afghanistan, who has commented today. And she has told that recently when she has talked to the Prime Minister, and he has assured that the National Register of Citizens was India's internal matter and it would not affect the people of Bangladesh at all. But yet we can know about the Bangladesh, how much reservation it is showing, especially after having cancelled around 3 to 4 meetings that were scheduled to be done this year, as well as they have even skipped the Raisina dialogue in which... So she says that the citizenship law was just unnecessary because this is the first time that the statement is being made by the first, by the Prime Minister of Bangladesh since the Citizenship Amendment Act came into prominence. She also mentioned that the Bangladesh government has told that minority communities did not leave the country of Bangladesh because of persecution, and maintained that there was no reverse migration from India either, right? But within India, people are facing many problems. That is what she has told about. This requires a special kind of attention, because again and again, the Home Ministry Amit Shah has been talking about the persecuted minorities which are coming from the Pakistan as well as Bangladesh and Afghanistan. So Pakistan haven't yet commented anything about it, right? But for the first time, Bangladesh is saying that there are no kind of persecuted religious minorities in her country. The same is the case with the Afghanistan, where the Afghanistan president is talking about Hamid Karzai, saying that we do not have a persecuted minorities. The whole country is persecuted, right? The well said word, because here he feels that all the religions in Afghanistan, including the Muslims as well as the Hindus and Sikhs, are suffering equally. So India should not talk only about the persecuted religions, the six religions which it is intending to give the citizenship to these people. But here he draws the attention of India by saying that almost all the people in the
are persecuted, because the whole country, they can see it, there has been a war and conflict for the long time. So all the religions in Afghanistan, Muslims, Hindus and the Sikhs, which are our three main religions, have suffered. That is what he has to say. Like, the feeling in Afghanistan is very different to what the perception here in India may be. And he even talks about the sentiments in Afghanistan. We know that we have cultural and religious ties with Afghanistan, and here he specifically mentions that the India may be become more sentiment towards the Afghanistan sentiments, which will be reflected in Indians, because here he has told the point that because they're all the Muslim countries.
The article here is talking about the endangered Irrawaddy dolphins, which are sighted in the Chilika Lake. Right, this lake is in home to the highest single lagoon population. So recently the dolphin census was conducted. So let us see about the Irrawaddy dolphin. The name Irrawaddy dolphin comes from the Irrawaddy River in Myanmar. So this Irrawaddy dolphin, although many times referred to Irrawaddy River dolphin, but this particular dolphin is not truly a river dolphin, but it is an oceanic dolphin that lives in the brackish water near coast, river mouths, as well as in estuaries, and hardly it ventures offshore, right? So it has established a subpopulation in the freshwater rivers, including Mekong River, Mekong, the Ganges, as well as the Irrawaddy River, from where it is taking the name, right? If you can see the range of this Irrawaddy dolphin, it extends from the Bay of Bengal to New Guinea as well as to the Philippines. In India, if you can see, mostly it is present in the brackish water of Chilika Lake, right? And the presence is also sometimes recorded in the Sundarban National Park.
Now they have conducted the census, and census have found that there is a continuous increase in the population of the Irrawaddy River. That is because the new type of conservation measures that the Chilika Development Authority has taken. So here, for the first time, they have sighted around 146 dolphins. This is in collaboration as the estimates of CDA is going on, which is counting dolphins around the year using the hydrophones, right? So now they have estimated around the population is from 133 to 172, and this confidence has stemmed from the fact that the dolphins were colonizing new areas which has been freed from the encroachment by pond as well as the farming fisheries. So here it shows an important thing: once the encroachment are getting cleared, these animals are showing the new conservation methods, they are responding to the new conservation methods, and they are seeing the increase in the population. So according to the hydrophone monitoring carried out, which is carried out year around the Chilika lakes, the highest number of Irrawaddy dolphins is around 20 to 25, which are moving around the Rajahans, followed by the Makamuk and the So coming to the IUCN status, it is an endangered, it comes under the endangered list, and it is an aquatic mammal, and it is protected under the CITES Appendix 1. The Irrawaddy dolphin is also listed in the Appendix 1 and in Appendix 2 of Convention on Conservation of Migratory Species of Wild Animals. The article here is a small one, but they are saying that the Mumbai is going to get back the mounted police. Here, this mounted police that we can see in the Chennai also, where usually the police are mounted on the horse so as to have a good access over the beaches. Now they felt that the Maharashtra government wants to bring back the unit which was disbanded in the year 1932 due to the growing vehicular traffic. So it will be set up in 6 months, so that whenever there is kind of protest kind of thing or the rally which is going on, usually it is not possible for a policeman who is standing equivalently on the ground in order to monitor such type of huge processions which happen. So a mounted unit will have a greater accessibility in viewing as well as the monitoring, because they say that a policeman on horseback will be equivalent to the 30 persons on the ground, right? Because the average speed of the patrolling rider will be more than 7 to 30 kilometers than the ones on the foot. So the Maharashtra government is going to bring back this mounted police. So maybe in the rallies and all, really it will be a good impact, but we have to see that sometimes during this protest or the rallies, the animal gets vengeant, it gets kind of excited, and it shows a different kind of attitude in the public arenas that we see in the processions when they're doing in a Kerala on the elephants and all. So the government, which is thinking to control the people, should also have a good compilement and make sure that these animals are not involved in the protest, which involves so much of roar and uproar, so that it will disturb the animals mentally.
The article here is talking about a judgment which is given by the Supreme Court. The petition here was filed by Pawan Hans Limited.
The company had implemented a PF trust regulation only with respect to the regular employees. Even though the term employee has been defined to include any persons who is employed directly or indirectly under the PF trust regulations. So the case here is about the contractual employees who have been seeking a parity with the regular employees who are covered under the Pawan Hans Employee Provident Fund trust regulations, right? So the company has filed a petition against the employees union who sought a uniformity in services conditions among the employees. So the Supreme Court has held in the judgment that the benefits of provident fund should also be extended to the contractual employees. The Supreme Court has held that such employees who draw wages and salaries directly or indirectly from the company are entitled to the provident funds benefited under the EPF Act. So the significance here is that the judgment is going to bring about a significant bearing on the large number of contractual employees
in other companies as well. Though it will be beneficial to the contractual employees, but it is going to add a lot of financial burden to the company. So now the companies, I feel that they will be changing this kind of concept called as contractual employees, and maybe they will put in it instead of to calling it as a contractual employees, they may come up with a term as temporary employees. So Supreme Court, although it has guaranteed this type of extension of provident fund under the contractual employees, but it should have given a more refinement about the terms of conditions of employment, so that the future companies, whoever are trying to employ the people on the contractual or on the temporary basis, they can avail the benefits of provident fund. Jallikattu, you cannot think of hosting a Jallikattu without having at least kind of incident-free kind of event that you cannot have. Even considering that every sport has an element of danger of injury, right? Especially in the contact sport that you can see in the hockey or you can see in the football, there will be definitely kind of injury in the contact sports. But the distinguished feature of events involving the animals is what is driven as instinct of self-preservation and anxiety, and they are not bound by the rules and reasons the way human participation is does. Like example, in every sport there will be an umpire who will regulate the humans. If at all they are doing something wrong, we can punish the humans or ban them from that particular sport. But that thing we cannot do with the animals, as we all know. But inevitably the human casualty are very, very higher, even though it has been long argued that even judicially determined that Jallikattu constitutes a grave violation of the animal rights and the perpetuation of cruelty on them. But yet, because of the popular sentiment as well as the political patronage and the cultural instinct to preserve practices that back on the horsery pass contribute to the collectively to continuation of this sport, right? The other virtues attributed to it include giving negative breeds a good shot at survival and an opportunity to the youth to develop a robust outlook. This same thing was even told by the Kamala Hassan, who has told that Jallikattu event will actually bring about a different kind of survival instinct among the youth if they participate in such type of sports. That is how they are not only rearing the hard breed of animals which will be useful in the breeding of genes, but also it will help the youth in order to develop a robust outlook, right? So above all, what ultimately needs the need of the hour is that any activity that is endangering the participants as well as the onlookers should be held under rigorous monitoring regulations and restrictions, and it is also time that appropriate protective gear is devised and made mandatory for the participation. Just like how we have made the mandatory of helmet, in the same way such type of garment so as to protect such type of injuries. The article here is talking about the Jallikattu event, which is organized as a part of celebration of Pongal in the Tamil Nadu region. Although the courts are seeing it as a cruelty on the bulls, on the animals, but it is celebrated as a display of valor among the Pongal season in the state, right? Now this particular program has brought about the tourist attraction also, but there are a lot of very less people who are showing a lot of concern about the Jallikattu event. Usually we have seen in two years back when the Jallikattu was banned in Tamil Nadu, there was a huge uproar in the Tamil Nadu region about the retention of the Jallikattu event. They were talking about the PETA, which has tried to ban this Jallikattu event. That was a foreign backed MNC which has different kind of economic benefits. For that reason they were saying that they are seeking a ban on Jallikattu. But the events today have shown totally a different gallop, because more than hundreds have been injured in this year's Pongal event, right? Which were not only, it did not hurt just the participants who were really participating in the event, not the owners alone, but also the onlookers who came to see here, right? So often if we can see, the injuries which are caused by the bull are very, very so deep that it is bringing about a nightmare among the doctors also in order to treat such kind of grievous injuries on the people.
So article here is arguing about what needs to be done for the Jallikattu event so as to bring a regulation, because ban is totally out of question after we have seen such type of human chain formation even in the Marina Beach in 2016, where people have resented against the act. So the Supreme Court itself have to take back its order on the ban of Jallikattu, and now they are asking, after seeing such type of deadliest events, they are asking that this must be done after the official permission and there must be definitely a supervision. If I can see the whole of Jallikattu event, there will be two gates where there will be entry of the bull, and then there will be an exit gate where usually we see the owner standing over there. After the bull's performance, usually they try to collect the bull at the exit gate. And the incident here, it is also noticed where the bull of another owner have come and hit the owner who was awaiting over there in order to collect his own bull. So what do we do with the Jallikattu is a major question here, right? So here the article here is talking about the quadratite agreement which was made by the central state government of Tripura, Mizoram, as well as the representatives of Bruce community. These Bruce communities are also called as Riangs, and they are spread in the northeastern states of Tripura, Assam, Manipur, as well as Mizoram. And this Bruce constitute the second largest ethnic group in the state of Mizoram, but in Tripura they are recognized as particularly vulnerable tribal group. In 1995, the Mizos, the majority tribe in the state of Mizoram, have demanded that the Bruce be left out of the state electoral rolls, as they contended that they are not indigenous to the state of Mizoram. But in 1997, the ethnic violence forced roughly half of the Bru population to flee the state in large numbers to the state of Tripura. Right, so their exodus in the year of 1997 was spurred by the violent crashes in the subdivision within the Riang dominated areas, when they demanded the creation of autonomous district council under the sixth schedule of the constitution in the western Mizoram, which was vehemently opposed by the Mizo groups. Right, so for this purpose, the center and the two states which are involved made the ninth attempt to resettle the Bruce in Mizoram. The first was done in the November 2010, when the 1,622 Bru families with around 8,000 members went back. But there was again a protest by the Mizos who have stalled the process in subsequent years. Now in June 2018, the Bru leaders especially have signed an agreement in Delhi with the center and the two state governments for providing a repatriation to the Mizoram, along with the rehabilitation package. However, the camp residents said that the package did not guarantee their safety in the state of Mizoram, and they were not happy with the deadline which was provided by the government. Thus, the fear of repeat of violence led to the failure of the agreements. Right, so now they have come up with a new kind of agreement which was recently signed by the Home Ministry Amit Shah, which will allow the Bruce refugees to permanently settle in Tripura if they want to stay on. But and also they will be provided with voting rights in Tripura. The Bruce who have returned to Mizoram in the 8 phases of repatriation since the year of 2009 cannot, however, come back to Tripura. So the fresh survey has been done in order to ascertain the number of those settled in the relief camps. So for them, they are going to give a special development package in addition to the 600 crore fund announced for the process, including the benefits of the migrants. Right, so now it is the role of the Tripura's erstwhile royal family, who are claiming that Bruce were originally from Tripura but had migrated to Mizoram after their homes were flooded due to the commissioning of Dumbarbor hydroelectric power project in South Tripura. So this is an effort to socially respected persons led to easy acceptance of Bruce by the Mizoram political system. So now they are going to donate around 35 lakh of land for the purpose, thus easing the pressure on government in search of the land. Right. But the concern here is coming not just how the Bruce were given a resettlement agreement, but it could also set a bad precedent and legitimate an ejection of minority communities by the ethnocentric centers.
So the displaced Brus who have returned to Mizoram have already began demanding a package equivalent to the ones who have stayed behind in Tripura relief camps. So this could actually fuel a conflict with the local Tripura people, right? And of course, if we see that most of the forests would be razed down so as to provide the land needed for settling the Brus, that will again impact on the environmental concern that the India has been showing. So ultimately, this Bru settlement has gone well all along with the government lines, because it is going to bring about many kind of ethnocentric fights among the people, especially which are dominated in the northeast region. Hope that the Bruce kind of settlement will not be resorted by the government here afterwards, but they will search for a permanent solution, and whatever the place they are providing, that they have to make sure that they are not cutting down on the forest areas of the northeast, which are very, very important for our environmental conservation.